just trying to change the world here, people.
Oh, really?
Facebooking and the tweeting and the Instagramming, all that would not exist without our understanding of science.
So it's amazing that you do that as an insult.
You mean true for you is different from true for anybody else? Have
yeah, absolutely, because I can't
prove either got to be true or not.
I can't, no, no.
Greetings, citizens of Netlandia. Welcome to a really radio episode, show, etc. 119A. That's 119A. This is a special about what has happened with the Republican National Convention and the emergence of the Republican Platform 2016. Now, yeah, so this could be a trigger warning because this is going to be, you know, the special part. This is going to be the Eat Your Vegetables on the Republican Party platform. Now, before you just hit next and go to show B, which will be the things that are more science-oriented and what's happening in the courts, news, perhaps something nice, and, of course, our picks. Before you do that, which, of course, I encourage you to do, before you do that, the reason that I personally want to go over the Republican platform is because this is the marching orders for the party. This is what they are stating, written, okay, what they stand for, what it is to be a Republican in 2016. If you do not agree with this, you are not a Republican. The party has moved on without you. I encourage you to absorb this, absorb it, and then take it to your right-leaning, conservative parents, grandparents, friends, Romans, countrymen, you know, whoever they might be, and ask them whether or not they really believe that, and then tell them, you know, it's in the Republican platform. You know they're going to do that, right? And then when they say no, you can then send them here, and we have a link to the PDF, and they can download it, and they can read it and weep, just like we're about to.
Or if they want to print it out, just remember, it is 66 pages.
It is 66 pages. It is. I did 4 per page double-sided, and it's still several pages here, and it's tiny, tiny print.
Is it 66 and two-thirds pages? Because that would be 66.666...
That repeating, of course.
Repeating, of course.
No, it's it is 60 pages numbered, but with all the other pages that are not numbered, it ends up being 66. Okay, so before we get into that, I did not have any audience feedback, but I'm sure that there ought to be some audience feedback for this episode. So go ahead and shoot us a voicemail. Send us an email. You can reach us at 470-222-6759, or you can reach us on the emails orellyradiopodcast@gmail.com. That's orellyradiopodcast at gmail.com. I think you know that by now, but, you know, sometimes you just got to spell it out. So, since this is all special and everything, I guess we'll do law and misorder, or whatever it happens to be.
Disorder?
Disorder. Law and disorder. Yeah. So I've got the PDF here, and we're going to follow it along. This is direct from the document. That wasn't just a lovely graphic that I had there.
Which is direct from GOP.gov.
Yeah, it's disturbing. This is the draft final. So this is it. let's see, what is the... Yeah, the link is Prodstatic. It's on Amazon AWS, so that's where they stored it. We dedicate this platform with admiration and gratitude to all those who stand strong in the face of danger. So the American people. Maybe. Why do I want to do some, like, crazy dictator voice?
Or Scottish in front of the people?
No, I want
to... all who stand strong in the face of danger.
No, I don't want to be Scottish. I want to be more dictatorial. You know,
that's fair.
Yeah.
You need to start yelling.
To all who stand strong.
Yeah.
In the face of danger.
We need a counter voice.
What? With Moose
those
and Squirrel?
American people may be protected against it.
Yeah, like that. That's
do
the
not
voice.
Give yourselves to brutes.
All right.
Those are the voices that automatically come out. Okay. So, anyway, they're immediately, with their preamble here, before the preamble, pre-preamble, they're dedicating the platform and pandering immediately to the military, the law enforcers, and first responders. I think first responders was pretty much a big afterthought there. Maybe that's the Giuliani clause. Yeah, yeah, trying to get that in.
Now
and
9/11.
Yeah, and their families, which is kind of weird because there's no period there, and then they capitalized and their families. So total afterthought. Anyway, I'm not going to nitpick too much. Ah, yes. Paid for by Committee on Arrangements for the 2016 Republican National Convention, not authorized by any candidate or candidate's committee. GOP Convention 2016.com. So now you know where it's from. Okay. So the preamble. This is where it starts to get super duper ugly immediately. Okay. With this platform, we, the Republican Party, affirm the principles that unite us in common purpose. This is what they think that you have to be, what you have to believe, to be a Republican. Okay? There's a lot of stuff in here that's attacking, basically, the Democratic Party. I know that last time, in the 2012 version, it was the DNC platform plus everything that attacks it. That was basically what the GOP party was.
Yeah.
It was like mild plagiarism in that way. So
we've gone way beyond mild now, but we'll get to that later.
Yeah, so right off the bat, I didn't mean to do that. Hang on. We believe in American exceptionalism. Okay, so nationalism, right off the bat.
The belief that we're better just because.
Yes.
And let me go this. The actual definition of exceptionalism, according to Wikipedia.
Okay.
Exceptionalism is the perception that a country, society, institution, movement, or time period is, quote-unquote, exceptional, example, i.e., unusual or extraordinary, in some way, and thus does not need to conform to normal rules or principles.
So...
and now we can...
we're above the law.
Yes.
Totally above the law. Okay.
We believe Americans don't have to follow any form of law. We are the law.
Yeah. Now, feel free and jump in here and read with me. You know, if you see something, guys, that's on this document that jumps out at you and bites you, please jump in. You know, otherwise it's going to get boring. So we don't want that. Obviously, they made this to be entertaining, right?
Really? Yeah.
Okay, so...
yeah. America.
Yeah. So then they basically reiterate what exceptionalism is, in that we believe the United States of America is unlike any other nation on Earth.
Whoa. What?
No, I can agree with that, just probably not in the way they think.
Yeah. Is exceptional because of our historic role, first as refuge, then as defender, and now as exemplar of liberty for the world to see. Really? Really? But we're closing our borders.
A person or thing serving as a typical example or excellent model.
Exemplar.
Exemplar. Yeah. they keep using these words.
They're using,
I don't think it means what they think it means.
They're using these words. What does this word mean? Yes. We affirm, as did the Declaration of Independence, that all are created equal, endowed with by their Creator with inalienable rights of life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness.
Lovely.
So immediately,
yeah, about that equality thing.
So how long did it take them to call out a God reference?
Third paragraph. Let it. Fourth paragraph.
Fourth
paragraph. If you count the first two as being a paragraph each.
Yeah. If you even can count that, yeah. We believe in the Constitution as our founding document. That's good, because it is.
Technically speaking, fourth sentence. So because
yeah, fourth sentence. Sentences. Yeah. We believe the Constitution was written not as a flexible document, but an enduring covenant.
Which is hilarious, given the fact the Founding Fathers gave us in exact writing exactly how to change it.
Yeah.
Which denotes it's flexible.
They made it to be changed through amendment.
What?
Isn't the Bill of Rights just an amendment list?
Essentially, yes.
Like, it wasn't even off the drafting table before they had to start making modifications.
Yep.
just saying. And then
we can't change it.
Yeah, and then they doubled down on that. We believe our constitutional system, limited government, separation of powers, federalism, and the rights of the people must be preserved uncompromised for future generations.
I would debate them when they put federalism in there.
I was thinking the same thing. It's like, really? Federalism?
For those people who don't know out there, as we get into definitions of things, a federalist form of government, which is what we have and what a lot of democracies out there actually have, is the states have certain powers, the national government has certain powers, and they're there. You don't start switching things back and forth. Again, the national government here can make treaties, it can raise the army, it can do all that kind of stuff. The state governments typically deal with things inside their own borders, as long as they don't cross powers. But, again, look at what the GOP's been doing, look at what a lot of people have been saying. They want a lot more power come back to the states, mm-hmm. which violates the federal principles. They want a confederation.
But they also want to be in. They want to be in control of all of them. All levels of government they want to have control over.
The original point of the Confederacy and the states' rights was so that the states could legislate slavery and maintain that status quo.
Yeah, each state still wanted to remain sovereign with its own rules and regulations up into itself and did not want to have a supernatural authority that they had to bow to. Well, guess what?
Yeah. Okay, so then they the editors didn't realize that this next sentence actually belonged in the next paragraph. We believe political freedom and economic freedom are indivisible. Then they say the exactly same thing. When political freedom and economic freedom are separated, both are in peril. When united, they are invincible.
There are words I want to put in there that obviously I think they took out.
I would like to just mention Keynesian economics.
That too, but honestly, it's political freedom and economic freedom for white people.
Ooh.
Yes, I'm going to go there, given some of the things that I've seen this week and some of the things that have come out of people's mouths. I'm going there.
He went there. He went there, ladies and gentlemen.
You
can reach him at Stephen at OReallyRadio.com.
As Mike would say, where's the lie?
Yeah, where's the lie? Where's the lie? We believe that people are the ultimate resource and that the people, not the government, are the best stewards of our country's God-given natural resources. Down with the EPA.
Coming out with that, the way that's written, as someone who's studied, and I know people are going to freak out about this, yes, I've studied some of Marxism. Some of it had good ideas.
You were a political science major, of course you did.
That's almost directly out of, like, end result communism.
Yeah, yes. when all the people are in charge.
Marx had the whole thing. There are actually two types of communism. You have type 1 and type 2.
Diabetes.
One becomes 2. One is the government handles everything and handles everything out. Type 2 is eventually that government withers away and the people by themselves are in full control. Guess what?
Yeah. Okay, so as Americans and as Republicans, we wish for peace. Really?
That's
really
that's we wish her peace, except for terrorist families.
Yeah, it's I
who we're going to commit war crimes on.
Yeah, Warhawks maybe. Anyway, so we insist on strength. We will make America safe. We seek friendship with all peoples and all nations, but we recognize and are prepared to deal with the evil in the world.
I had just an image flash through my head. I'm sorry. I hear that statement. The whole, yeah, you know, we wish for peace. We insist on strength. We make America safe. We ask for friendship of all peoples. I just imagine the standard thing you see in almost all those weird terrorist cartoons where the guy's sitting there talking to the camera about how wonderful life is and how great everything is, and you've got somebody off camera with an AK-47 pointed at him that you can't see.
Yep. We come in peace. Shoot to kill. Shoot to kill. Shoot to kill. We come in peace. Shoot to kill.
Dr. Demento.
Shoot to kill. And, yep. So, I can't really buy that one. Now, I'm sure.
They come in peace. As long as they're the ones on top.
Yeah, I'm sure that people wish for peace. The method that they're using to get to peace is by having the biggest stick. It's intimidation. You know, you can't... Don't go to war with us, because we'll kill you.
We have bigger guns and a better army.
Yeah, we're right, because we can kill you. That is... That's that mindset.
Yeah.
Might is right.
That's pretty much it, yeah. And based on these principles, this platform is an invitation and a roadmap. It invites every American to join us and show the path to a stronger, safer, and more prosperous America.
For the 1%.
For the 1% of the 1%. This platform is optimistic because the American people are optimistic.
I'm optimistic to see how optimistic they're being.
I'm not optimistic when somebody tells me that they're optimistic.
That's true.
You know, it's like, okay, you're having to point out that you're optimistic. Okay.
The man who says he's king isn't king. If you have to say you're king, you're not a king.
Yeah. This platform lays out, in clear language, the path to making America great and united
again.
It's
about time. We've been waiting for this for over 2 decades. I'm waiting for this clear language of a path.
In clear
Let's
language?
Go.
At a fourth grade reading level. You know, except, of course, for things like exemplar that you might have to look up. You know, very clear language.
Very clear.
You know, these words that you do not mean what they think it means. For the past 8 years, America has been led in the wrong direction. So in the preamble, it only took that long. They only had one section, one column of here's kind of what we believe. Now we're going to start attacking. They couldn't even get out of the preamble before they start attacking the other party. Our economy has been unnecessarily weak and stagnant wages. That's just wrong. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, we have metrics that show the economy has strengthened.
However, the next statement is actually true. I will actually give them that, finally.
Americans have earned and deserve...
The next sentence of that paragraph that you didn't get to.
People living paycheck to paycheck are struggling, sacrificing, and suffering.
That's true.
However, that also has been true forever.
Yes. But it's a truth. I will give them a truth.
Yeah, but it's not for the past 8 years. It's more like for the past 80 years.
The sentence before that is even got some truth in it. Our economy has become unnecessarily weak with stagnant wages. Yeah, because you won't raise the minimum wage, which exists precisely because if they could pay you less, they would.
Well, again, the minimum wage, as much as I've heard people argue about this, when the minimum wage was set up, the exact actual language used is it was a living wage. It was designed so if you go to work, you will not earn less than what it takes to live on.
Americans have earned and deserve a strong and healthy economy. Yes.
Nah. Yes. Okay, but, another truth. We've got two.
Yes, but these are like boilerplate for any year they build this.
Hey, I've got to give them whatever I can give them because we know what's coming up.
I know. It's just, it's very generic. You know, this could also be in the DNC platform. You know, it doesn't have to be in either one. That's center aisle stuff right here.
Tune in 2 weeks, folks.
Yeah, tune in 2 weeks when we have the DNC party platform, which, yes, we will do this too. Equal billing. And if there's a Libertarian and if there's a Green Party one, we'll go through that too. Because why not? I bet they're shorter.
Yeah.
A lot shorter.
How about the rent is too damn high party platform?
Ain't nobody got time for that.
That's a real short platform. To the point, I still like that guy.
Mm-hmm.
That was issue I could get behind.
Oh, God. Yeah, that's true. Okay. Our standing in world affairs has declined significantly. Our enemies no longer fear us, and our friends no long trust us.
One, that was funny.
No two, long trust gee, us.
I wonder why.
I no long trust editor and proofreader.
Yeah, somebody need to go, wait, guys, oops.
Yeah, okay.
But, yeah, if you look at how we've treated our allies.
We've become untrustworthy because of the things that we've done. We go in and we attack, and we've been doing this for way too long.
Or we don't stand with them. Again, our standing world affairs has declined significantly. Yeah, because when people actually ask for our help and have the right to ask for our help, we go, no, sorry, we're not following that part of the treaty. No.
People want and expect an America that is the most powerful and respected country on the face of the earth.
Yeah. In America, yes, I agree. We would love that.
I would say Americans want and expect that. Other people want us to shut up and get the hell out of their lives and their
small
countries
that we're protecting want that.
Yeah. Our allies that are on really good terms with us. Yeah, sure. Okay.
Several dictators across the world during the 1980s loved that.
Yeah. The men and women of our military remain the world's best. They have been shortchanged in numbers, equipment, and benefits by a commander-in-chief who treats the armed forces and our veterans as a necessary inconvenience.
Shall we go through all the times
how many bills
have killed the veterans' bills?
How many bills have they done this to? I mean,
Or the, hi, yeah, the Democrats trying to cut a military spending bill because a lot of people in the military, not the Pentagon, mind you, but the lower level people who are actually in like procurement and everything else are going, guys, we don't need this stuff. Stop buying it.
Yeah.
And they try to go, yeah, we can stop that. And then, of course, why are you trying to cut down the cost of the military or spending on the military? Because literally the military is telling us we don't need this. $1.35 trillion for a plane that doesn't work.
Oh, hang on. It gets even better. The president and the Democratic Party have dismantled America's system of health care. They have replaced it with a costly and complicated scheme that limits choice and takes away our freedom. Debatable.
No. Yeah.
Very, very debatable. But they have not dismantled America's system of healthcare. They provided a new one.
Yeah. Now, I will agree there are times where it comes costly and complicated.
But that's the insurance companies.
But yeah, I have a problem with any time a government forces the purchase of private materials.
Yes.
Which is my big problem with the ACA. I'm like, no, it literally takes the government goes, I don't want to see the mega corporations of Shadowrun become an actual thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Even if they're run by Elon Musk. Even then.
Well, no, that'd be the one that'd be great. But the problem is you'd have ones run by Trump.
Could you imagine
other groups?
Could you imagine a Musk arcology?
It would be amazing.
That would be pretty cool. Okay, moving on.
Where do you live? Musk.
I live in Musk. Yeah. The president and the Democratic Party have abandoned their promise of being accountable to the American people.
Change that with the GOP, and yes.
They have nearly doubled the size of the national debt.
patently false.
Was it doubled?
It has essentially doubled.
But again, the base number versus the actual what's actually used is... Here's where we get into complicated things, which will take me a little while to break down.
There's a lot to unpack here, as Daniel would say. Yeah. But there is no time. We must move on. They refuse to control our borders, but try to control our schools, farms, businesses, and even our religious institutions. What? They have directly attacked the production of American energy and the industry-related jobs that have sustained families and communities. Coal. Period.
They have not...
And anti-fracking.
Production of energy. They've been trying to make it better and, kick us into the 21st century rather than the 18th.
Yeah. Actually, the biggest anachronism that I've ever seen is clean coal.
Well, again, I've seen
have
a way to make it.
Have people ever
work.
Been to a coal mine? Or seen pictures of people in a coal mine?
Oh, yeah, I've been there.
It's not clean.
I've had family that worked there. I've had family that died in coal mine.
Yeah, it's not a clean industry. I don't care what you say. No.
Just the burning of it, yeah, we have ways to make just that section of it clean.
But even that's not clean.
Well, no, there's a neat way I've seen that actually makes it clean. It's very cool. It's done small test beds. It's also expensive because it's brand new technology.
Yeah.
But it's the problem is like concrete, like you said before, it's also everything else.
Yeah.
Because people don't realize once you dig coal out, it has to be washed. That's a lot of water.
Yeah. And then you've got, what was it? I can't remember.
Slurry.
Is it just, I know that's the type of thing it is, but I think there's a name, of course, for it.
Not drinkable.
Yeah, non-potable water, that's for sure. Yeah, nasty? Yeah, nasty will work.
Yeah.
Anyway, moving on. If you know what that's called, the runoff from the initial rinsing of the coal, hey, send us an email. OReallyRadioPodcast@gmail.com or send us a text or something, 470-222-6759.
And if my family is listening, sorry that I don't remember that term.
Yeah, if you know, shoot it.
Well, no,
shoot
my mother, coal miner's daughter, most of my family from that section of the world up in West Virginia, coal miners. So
yeah.
I should know, I'm just sad that I don't.
Yeah. The president has been regulating to death a free market economy that he does not like and does not understand. He defies the laws of the United States by refusing to enforce those with which he does not agree. And he appoints judges who legislate from the bench rather than apply the law.
You know, I would really like to go back to their earlier platform, say around 2000, and see what they thought about the Supreme Court legislating from the bench in their favor.
It's probably just not in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. But also, they haven't...
They're not legislating
from
the bench.
Well, they're not letting him actually appoint anybody that has done any legislating from the bench.
Mm-hmm.
That hasn't happened. He hasn't even selected people that have done that.
Well, yeah,
he's been going for, like, really moderate judges.
Well, yeah, they've also screamed bloody murder about the whole, look at these laws he's being passed, look at how the Supreme Court's doing this whole thing, legislating from the bench. And anybody who actually understands even the basics of law and how the Supreme Court works goes, no, they're doing literally exactly what they're designed to do.
Yep.
They're not legislating.
Ow, podcat, ow. Oh,
they're not
I'm
drawing
bleeding.
Blood like that.
I'm bleeding. Yeah, okay, that's fine. I thought I got that claw. I did not. Okay. I got it now. Woo. Okay, we have podcat. We're good to go.
But it's that whole... No, they're literally doing what they're doing. It's interpreting... They interpret the law. That is literally what their entire branch is designed to do.
Yeah. Read a book. You're making us look like jerks. Okay. We, as Republicans and Americans, cannot allow this to continue. That is why... The many sections of this platform affirm our trust in the people, our faith in their judgment, and our determination to help them take back their country.
What
are their people?
Well, anybody that espouses to be a Republican, of course. I guess. This means... removing the power from unelected, unaccountable government basically stripping judges, appointed officials.
Well, but there's actually a lot of judges and EPA. Having now met one. Almost every single federal judge is elected. They may be appointed for circuit court judges, they may be appointed by a governor, but then when the next election cycle comes around, they actually have to campaign to keep that seat.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I've made friends with a Ninth Circuit Court judge in Orlando, and he actually told me about his campaigning experience, because he was appointed by the governor, but then had to campaign to keep his slot.
Yeah, and circuit court, that is federal. Okay.
But most people don't know that.
This means relieving the burden and expense of punishing government regulations. They want to deregulate everything. That's the Libertarian Party. That's not the Republican Party.
Yeah. Just remember, we have to deregulate everything so that you're perfectly free to drink all the lead-based water you want.
That way you can set your faucet on fire. Absolutely.
Yep.
It'll be great.
Or that too. Kill the entire Florida fishing industry in South Central.
Yeah. That whole EPA
thing. Set your lead-based water on fire. I'm okay with this.
Screw the environment. I'm cold now. Yeah. Ozone. Okay. And this means returning to the people and the states the control that belongs to them. It is the control and the power to make their own decisions about what's best for themselves and their families and communities.
Except the problem is they're getting past the whole idea of the common good. When your actions impact more than just your particular state, it is now considered something in the common interest.
This platform is many things. A handbook for returning decision-making to the people.
Sounds good. No substance.
A guide to the constitutional rights of every American. And a manual for the kind of sustained growth that will bring opportunity to all those on the sidelines of our society.
Unless they start talking about bringing back the 1950s platform with a 90% top tax rate, I'm going to call bullshit on that.
Yeah, it's pretty much not the
way this
works.
I'm going to go ahead and predict that it will provide a list of goals and not provide any path for how to get there.
Of course.
And here's God again. Every time we sing God Bless America, we are asking for help.
Yep.
Because remember, the Republican God is a wish-granting machine. If you just believe hard enough,
Ronald
your
Reagan,
candidate will get elected.
Can you please make sure that my interest rate is low on my new Volvo?
Trickle down.
We ask for divine help that our country can fulfill its promise. We earn that help by recommitting ourselves to the ideas and ideals that are the true greatness of America.
Okay, so essentially they're saying we ask for divine help and we earn that help. So essentially they're saying that their view of God is as a quest giver in an MMO.
Yes. He has the exclamation point.
And you need to do a fetch quest.
Yeah. And it's tithing or something. But that's sacred taxation. Yeah, that's it.
Damn 10 wolf belts.
Oh.
Every Republican.
So this was by Chairman John Bracero and co-chairs Mary Fallon and Virginia Fox. So white. So very white.
Oh, we'll get to pictures of whiteness later.
Yeah. The Paul Ryan selfie with all the interns.
Yeah, and then the House Republican interns and the House Democratic interns.
Yeah, that was definitely a lot of different shades of people on the Democratic side.
One was we're sticking with the white. The other one was we have a color palette.
So, let's pick and choose here. The table of contents. restoring the American dream. A rebirth.
I wonder what their American dream is.
Well, yeah, none of this makes a whole lot of sense.
Winning the lottery for each and every person who votes Republican.
So this is it, though. There's only, you know, six sections here. Restoring the American dream.
What's number 41? What's on page 41?
America resurgent. America resurgent.
Yeah, that's like, okay,
I think we can skim everything up until then.
We're going to go back and start collapsing South American dictators?
Maybe. I don't know. Well, that'd be insurgent, wouldn't it?
No, resurgent. No. We're going back to what we were doing.
Back. We got to go back to the future, Marty.
No, that would be invade Iran. Huh. That's next on the list.
But we don't have a Shah to prop up.
Doesn't matter. We'll find one.
We'll have one in Iraq. We'll find one. We'll put one in. It'll be fine. Okay, so restoring the America dream, a rebirth of constitutional government. America's natural resources, agriculture, energy, and the environment. Government reform. Great American families, education, health care, and criminal justice.
You're talking just about the Bushes there.
Ooh, that's sick burn.
And now Trump. And great American families. Nobody else, just the great families.
Yeah, and, well, criminal justice, yeah. and America resurgent. So those are some interesting ones. This page intentionally left blank. Okay. Restoring the America dream. American dream. Let me think here. I'm trying to be open-minded. I really am. Because I want there to be some substance here that informs that these are people that truly want what's best for America.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
I want there to be that shining light somewhere that says that these are not reptiloids that are working for the central bank Rothschilds or something. You know, I want there to be something genuine and not weasel words and conniving and complete destructuring that only favors the ultra rich.
Well, there's also the filler.
It's a lot of filler. Yeah, it's a lot of filler.
Hey, but they mention Reagan.
Did they already? Yeah, they did.
In the first section,
they
mentioned Reagan.
They did indeed. President Reagan, right there. Yeah, right there. Oh, man. Okay. All right. Restoring the American dream. So, anyway, that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for that substance here. And the preamble, basically, you're not going to get that if you're attacking the other party. I want to see what you believe standing alone. You know, don't compare yourself to the other people. Let them describe themselves. Let you describe yourself. That's what I want to see. And so far, that was only like 8 paragraphs, and they were short, like 1-sentence run-on paragraphs at that. That, just to review, we believe the Constitution was not written as a flexible document, but an enduring covenant. Political freedom and economic freedom are indivisible, so money is speech.
Yep.
So those with the money get to make the rules, basically. So that they are strict constitutionalists where that document does not change. So they do not believe in growth. They do not believe in change in any way. And if they want to dismantle the EPA and environmental protections, they don't believe in science. Because the reasons that we have an environmental protection agency is to protect it, to protect the environment so that we don't kill ourselves.
And remember, science possibly gets in the way of growth and, you know, prosperity.
And Jesus.
Except when it makes plastics and things, you know. Yeah.
And guns, bombs, helicopters, tanks.
Right.
And gasoline.
And
GPS satellites.
And they specifically called out that they want to be the biggest military ever so that people fear us for respect.
We are the biggest military.
Yeah, but we're not big enough.
Well, technically speaking, Iraq had a million-man army.
Yeah, but they had no power.
We rolled over it like it was nothing.
Yeah. Okay, you've got men on the ground. We don't need to be on the ground. Good on you. Okay. parting shots on just a preamble?
I'm ready for the show to continue because that was a nice little aperitif. Yeah, aperitif, little beginning thing. Okay, I got a sample. I got a small taste, a sip.
Give me the actual cocktail.
Inflexible, military dominant nationalism. That's my takeaway. And
I really want to go to the Nazi platform at this point.
Why not?
1938 Nazi platform.
Sure.
And then compare it with this. And just see.
Pull it up. That'll be a blog post I will be happy to put on the page. Absolutely happy to put on. Okay. Rebuilding the economy and creating jobs. We are the party of a growing economy that gives everyone a chance in life, an opportunity to learn, work, and realize the prosperity freedom makes possible.
I'm sorry, I'd have to start with the...
Freedom? Just freedom?
Well, beyond that, the opportunity to learn, work, and realize prosperity, okay, so, except in order to learn currently, you have to go, to properly learn, you have to go $50,000 in debt, unless you get a small loan of $1 million from your dad.
Well, let's see. Let's scroll through a little bit here. Actually, I did find that in the 2012 party platform that this box that they put in the middle is really descriptive. Like, that's the summation of everything on that page.
Yeah, but
somehow,
the problem is having
that's a goal.
Followed it, it's also the Republicans consider the establishment of a pro-growth tax code a moral imperative. Means they don't want a tax code.
Yeah, that would be the subtext. It's like, and how do you do that? You get rid of the tax code.
I think it's the idea of, I forget whose platform it was, who basically said, government is the enemy. The idea is to shrink government to the point that you can drown it.
So they're Marxists after all.
I will actually find if I can pull up the quote. It's from Grover Norquist.
Oh, Norquist, nice.
I don't want to abolish government. I simply want to reduce it to the size where I can drag it into the bathroom and drown it in a bathtub.
Nice. Nice. Oh, so
if
yeah,
you
this
kill
is...
If you prefer to get money, you can do that.
So the Restoring the American Dream basically talks about taxes. So that they've named it wrong. Because the headings are rebuilding the economy and creating jobs, fair and simple taxes for growth, our tax principles, a competitive America, a winning trade policy, freeing financial markets, responsible home ownership and rental opportunities, America on the move, whatever the hell that means, building the future, technology, ooh, scary things, building the future, America's electric grid, startup century, small business and entrepreneurship, the Federal Reserve, workplace freedom for a 21st century workforce.
That just simply means right to work so you can go wherever you want to work.
After you have been fired for...
But of course, they always assume it's the whole thing like with voting with your feet. They assume you have the money to do so.
Then,
which after they abolish the minimum wage, obviously your wages will go up because why would they go any other direction?
Clearly, federal workforce serving the people and reducing the federal debt. which, by the way, is one of the smallest paragraphs in the whole thing.
Which, considering how much they like to talk about it,
yeah,
surprising.
Let me just scroll down to that, because that's amusing, at the very least. Several pages, I just went through all those, but there, reducing the federal debt. That's all they say about that. Our national debt is a burden on our economy and families. The huge increase in the national debt demanded by and incurred during the current administration has placed a significant burden on future generations. We must impose firm caps on future debt, accelerate the repayment of the trillions we now owe in order to reaffirm our principles of responsible and limited government, and remove the burdens we are placing on future generations. A strong economy is one key to debt reduction, but spending restraint is a necessary component that must be vigorously pursued.
So, again,
I don't actually disagree with that, mostly.
I don't disagree with the goal, but I disagree with the concept that they're the ones to implement it, considering that given their history of adding to the national debt consistently year over year at double-digit percentages to their deficit spending every year they've been in power when they have the presidency.
Their goal of reducing the national debt and repaying, cool. However, the way to do that does not exist, and is exactly entirely counter to everything they just say in this first thing, because it is all about raising taxes, because that's how the government gets money.
Yeah.
And that's how the government pays off its stuff, is you have to raise the taxes.
Yeah, you cannot pay down debt when you're not making enough to pay the debt.
What they're saying here,
and your paycheck
is going,
is our tax dollars.
What they're saying here is the best way to do everything is let's go with austerity.
Except for the military. And that's the biggest drain on our government.
Or their own finances, which I agree is a very tiny drop in the bucket. Yeah.
And Mama Van, you open up a can of worms there by saying it's easy, just file bankruptcy. Debt be gone. Well, yes,
I wish we could.
That is the Trump method. But that's not what the federal government can do.
It works a little differently in the
that is then
national
called
level.
Well, yeah, the main problem with that is there is no authority above the nation state.
Yeah.
We are a nation state. If there was authority above us, we could go, okay, look, we don't have any money, we're just declaring bankruptcy, and they could go, okay, it's why a person can do it, because you have things above them.
A state like Florida could declare bankruptcy.
Then they
Detroit.
Will eventually.
And then,
for example, Detroit did declare
bankruptcy. Well, Detroit would then be that's as a city government, then declares bankruptcy to the state government. But if an entire state, say Michigan, then declares bankruptcy, that would then go to the national government. Greece. The only reason that they could possibly file bankruptcy in any way, shape, or form is because they're a member state of the EU. So they're going to the EU with hat in hand saying, we screwed up. Please help. Mm-hmm. You know, the United States, there's no economy bigger than the United States. We can't do that. And many of the reasons that... Many of the reasons that the other world economies run is because they own our debt and we pay interest on it. That's how the money changes hands.
They do an incredible amount of trading with us, a la China.
Yeah.
And China is a perfect example also, because they are using our currency as the backstop for their own.
Yeah. It's not
their reserve currency.
It's not the gold standard. It's the dollar standard. The American economy is the gold standard for how other governments establish their baseline currency. Yeah, wrap your brain around that one, but that's how it works. So if America defaults, then other global economies falter. It's not that they can't reestablish
America
themselves.
They tank with us.
Yeah.
It is a literal domino effect.
We will literally.
The nice thing is, less developed countries won't have the problem, but we will crash what is commonly known as the first world.
Yeah. Now, the thing is, it doesn't really hurt us to have the debt either.
No.
That's the weird thing.
It's good for us to have the debt, in truth.
It's
to a certain amount of debt. I will agree, exceptional debt is where things go, okay, why do you have... Yeah. But a certain amount of debt is good for a country to have, because it means you're a player in the world market.
Yeah. Now there is, of course, the whole inflationary aspect of that. So if the Federal Reserve started to do some really funny things, then we could start to pay down the national debt, but then we might also incur absurd inflation rates on the dollar value.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, where a loaf of bread now costs $1 zillion, you know, and all the money that you did have is worthless. You know, it's a fine line when you're working with fiat currency that is not backed by gold or any other, you know, solid thing. So, yeah, macroeconomics at its finest, we really should not default, and we can't declare bankruptcy because we would not be declaring bankruptcy to anybody else. For us, it would be a default on our debts to other nations, and then we'd bring them down too.
Yep.
So it's a bad idea.
Our country credit rating would tank.
Yeah.
All government services would stop because there's no money.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just...
Yeah. It is at this point where the, well, why can't you balance your own checkbook analogy for home versus government breaks down, because it's just different at that level.
Government is not a business.
Now, however, with this, I fully encourage them to actually come up with a budget that is balanced and doesn't work on deficit spending. Because, please, a balanced budget would be paying down that debt as well, where you're not spending as much as you're bringing in and plus. You know, anytime they say that we've reduced the deficit, no, you've reduced deficit spending, which means you're still incurring more national debt, just at a slower rate than the previous time you did a budget. No, yeah. you need to remove all deficit spending.
Again, it's like what you said before. It comes down to Keynesian economics, where at the top swing, when the economy is essentially, you know, you're in a car and the engine is running wildly out of control, you want to put the brakes on that so the engine doesn't burn itself out. That's why you raise taxes through the roof to rein that horse in, to put those brakes on so the engine doesn't burn out and the economy doesn't collapse. It's also why when you come off that hill coming down, you want to start spending and spending with abandon, especially as you get lower and lower, and do massive debt spending, because you want to, again, like a car whose engine isn't working is going down a hill, you want to be able to pop that clutch and get the engine to start. You can worry about how it's going to work once the engine's running again. And just with Keynesian, you know, you'll start not debt spending as much. You'll start bringing taxes back up and everything else to start repaying what you've done. Problem is, we've got, because of these ideas, because of GOP and their economic views, it's been, all this debt spending, but then we're also cutting taxes.
There are some things in here that are disturbing. You know, I'm cool with mostly what they say about, you know, reducing the debt. If they actually reduce the debt at all, cool. Please, go ahead. If we're a strong enough economy, we should be able to do that. Instead of just spending and putting things on the proverbial national debt credit card, you know, we should be able to bring that down. We also don't need a whole bunch more warships. We also don't need tanks. We don't need the F-35.
There's no more big players to fight.
Yeah.
I mean, you've got the dragon, the rising dragon in the east. However, we're still bigger than they are, and it's all about the projection capability of power. Mm-hmm. Militarily wise, we can project power better than anybody else. We can project force better than any other country in the world. Give us 6 months and we can deploy 2 million people on the field.
Well,
no one else can do that. We can do that anywhere in the world.
No other military right now, besides ours, has fought in a sizable war.
When was the last time we were not in war?
We have actual veterans with actual combat experience, and we have a ton of them.
Yeah. When was the last time that America was not in a conflict in another nation?
We're constantly flexing.
I think there were a few years in the 90s.
I think, like I think those were the CIA government actions, though, that were just dark.
Wasn't military. Technically wasn't military.
Right. Technically. That doesn't count. No.
But looking at this, taking it a step up, I'm reading over a federal workforce serving the people.
Where are you here?
The paragraph above, or the section above.
Oh, okay.
The federal debt. Going through this, the federal workforce is larger and more highly paid than ever. The taxpayer spends an average of $35,000 a year per employee on non-cash benefits, triple the average non-cash compensation of the average worker in the private sector. Federal employees receive extraordinary pension benefits and vacation time wildly out of line with those of the private sector. Gee, I wonder why.
It's because you vote for your own raise, people.
No, but it's beyond that. Because they're talking about your standard federal employees. They're not talking about Congress. They're talking about your employees.
Yeah.
But you're looking further, and you're like, okay, I know where it's coming from, but they actually, in a way, get into it. Yeah, we urge Congress to bring federal compensation and benefits in line with the standards of most American employees. A Republican administration should streamline personal procedures to expedite the firing of bad workers, tax cheats, and scammers. Here's where it gets really, really puts the nail in it. The unionization of the federal workforce, first permitted by Democrat presidents in the 1960s, should be reviewed by the appropriate congressional committees to examine its effect on the cost, quality, and performance of the civil service. Union representatives in the federal workforce should not be paid to conduct union business on the public's time. AKA, let's destroy the federal unions.
That falls in line with their anti-union.
Anti-union, sentiment. Yeah. That's been something for a very long time.
Not much surprise there. But yeah,
I grew up with my parents always, poo-pooing unions. And the more I learned about unions and collective bargaining, I'm like, why is that a bad thing? I mean,
hell,
seriously.
If I stay at my current job, I'm tempted to try to start one.
I'm not sure that you'd be able to in Florida. That's the problem. There are, of course, unions in Florida, but we are a right-to-work state, which means a right to fire you for whatever reason we like state.
Yeah, those unions that exist in Florida have their bases and work with companies that exist outside of just Florida.
Yeah, they have to. They have to. Okay, so there's so much to unpack. That I think we're going to have to mosey along. Again, again, we've got the link to the PDF. Please go look, read through it. You know, it's not a novella. You know, it's small enough. You can go through it. I recommend go ahead. Get your highlighter out and just start going through it and read between the lines a little bit. Like, what does that really mean? It's like, okay, those are pretty flowery words and almost prose. It's not clear language. They're lying there. This is not clear language.
I would encourage people to look at it through the lens of, could we define what is a goal and what is the actual path to obtain that goal?
Yeah.
And is the language actually there to obtain the goal? Have they told you how they're going to do it? Or are they just saying, yeah, we're going to do the thing?
There's no backbone to the plan. It's just, this is the way it is, and this is why we need to change it. We're not going to tell you how to change it because we don't know. But
no,
we're not going to say that.
They know what they're going to do. The problem
Nothing?
With telling you what they're going to do is it's not going to work. Because nobody who has budget issues in their home says, you know what I need to do? I need to take a voluntary pay cut, and then I need to spend more money. And that is historically what the Republican Party does now.
Yeah. Moving on a bit.
So this is the God section.
Well, yeah, this is part of that, but there's a couple parts that I just, in a quick read through, I just suddenly went, okay. The second paragraph on the first column, very beginning, we reaffirm the Constitution's fundamental principles. Limited government, okay. Separation of powers, okay. Individual liberty, all right. And the rule of law, all right. We denounce bigotry, racism, anti-Semitism, ethnic prejudice, and religious intolerance. Therefore, we oppose discrimination based on race, sex, religion, creed, disability, or national origin, and support statutes to end such discrimination.
Except for those Mexicans.
And Muslims.
Or those Muslims.
And Muslims.
Or gays.
And totally the gays, yeah.
Or violent black people.
Oh, actually, they did not say sexual orientation, did they? They didn't. No, we reserve the right to still be bigots on that.
Yeah.
As the party of Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln was not this kind of Republican.
No.
They fail to understand history.
And well, they don't care about history. They only care about branding.
Yeah, it's all branding at that point. Because, Abraham Lincoln
is a sales pitch. This is not...
Yeah.
How we're going to run the country. This is a sales pitch.
Yeah, this is less a party platform and more a sales pitch. Yeah.
We continue to encourage equality for all. Well, actually, let's go back up to the top because, I'm an atheist, so I'm interested when politics and government and the separation of church and state get all intermingled here. So
sentence three.
Yeah. That God bestows certain inalienable rights on every individual, thus producing human equality, that government exists first and foremost to protect those inalienable rights, that man-made law must consist with God-given natural rights, and that if God-given natural inalienable rights come in conflict with government, court, or human-granted rights, God-given natural inalienable rights always prevail, that there is a moral law recognized as the law of nature and of nature's God, and that American government is to operate with the consent of the governed.
Okay, they got that last part correct.
That's one sentence.
Yeah. I want to know what their view of God-given natural inalienable rights is.
The cherry-picked portions of the Bible that support their bigotry.
Well, no, but I want them specifically. I want to hear from them specifically. What is that? Because, yeah, that's a great flag-waving statement. I want to get cheers from the crowd by saying this. Cool. But what does it actually mean? That's what I want to know. I want to make somebody state that out loud.
How can you be the party of the Constitution that does not mention God, but is all God, 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 God? And if God says one thing and it disagrees with the Constitution, God wins.
Yeah.
Not God wins law, but God wins.
Well, we'll get to God wins law, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure. It'll end up in there somewhere. Oh. Okay, yeah, the United States, the world's freest and most prosperous nation. Okay. There are other nations that are equally free.
Actually, other nations have more freedom than us.
Yeah, at least that. Oh, gosh. Okay, our Constitution is in crisis? Fear, 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 fear more fear.
Refer to the last episode we had where we talked about the fact that conservative people tend to be more fear reactionary.
Yeah.
There's some things in sentence three of that giant paragraph, which is basically halfway through the paragraph, that I shake my head at because...
Which one?
Again, president has refused to defend or enforce laws he does not like, used executive orders to enact national policies in areas constitutionally reserved solely to Congress, made unconstitutional recess appointments to Senate-confirmed positions, directed regulatory agencies to overstep their statutory authority, and failed to consult Congress regarding military actions overseas. That last one, Bush, yeah. The first one, not the second,
mm-hmm.
And almost every Republican president, because they're allowed to for 90 days. People forget that. That's actually in the Constitution.
Yeah, it is.
Unconstitutional recess appointments, they weren't unconstitutional when Republicans have done it.
Yeah, it's...
Republican presidents have done it. Bush made...
It's allowed.
...numerous ones.
Yeah, it's allowed. It's not stated that you can't do it in the Constitution, therefore it's not unconstitutional.
Mm-hmm.
It just because you say it's unconstitutional doesn't mean it is. It's why we have the Supreme Court to define
those
things.
Yeah, they're
the
ones who say whether it is or not.
Yeah.
He has changed what John Adams called a government of laws and not of men into just the opposite. However, there's a funny thing, the fact that they're quoting John Adams in this. And you'll love this. I think you already know this, Andy.
Mm.
For our listeners out there, John Adams did something that almost no president since him has done. When he was sworn in, you know, when the presidents are sworn in and everything else, you've got a priest there, they swear on the Bible. John Adams refused a Bible. He swore on a law book.
Yep.
Because he believed, as a founding father, the Constitution, it was the law, not a religion, not anything else. I am swearing on mm-hmm. a book of laws to defend the law.
Makes sense. Makes sense to me.
Makes sense to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Unless they actually want you to govern based on religion.
If I ever get in office, I swear, mm-hmm. as religious or spiritual as I am, I'm swearing on a book of laws. I'm not swearing to defend my religion or my beliefs. No, I'm swearing to defend everybody's, which means I swear on the law.
So, yeah, in a free society, the primary role of government is to protect the God-given inalienable rights of its citizens. These constitutional rights. Okay, so...
Legitimate powers of government are rooted in the consent of the American people. Unless you're a woman.
Yeah, that's right here. Yep, mm-hmm.
For the judiciary, yeah.
I highly recommend, for those that are just listening... I do have a multimedia presentation I'm going through. I'm highlighting the sections that we're talking about here, trying to go through this document and try to give it a fair shake, if at all possible.
Andy,
I'm losing
the sentence directly below the one you highlighted. Think about that.
Okay, well, let's see. Foreign laws and precedents should not be used to interpret our Constitution or laws, nor should foreign sources of law be used in state courts' adjudication of criminal or civil matters.
What's the Bible?
A 2,000-year-old book of Jewish law.
Foreign laws that they use to interpret the Constitution and laws.
Irony.
Oh, wow. Yeah, that's good. That's good. I see what you did there.
This is why I'm here.
I see what you did there. Calling them out. So,
yep.
Yeah. Yeah, fun. Okay.
But going back to the first column top, first paragraph.
They name drop George Washington, too.
Oh.
Yeah. So we've already had Reagan. We've had John Adams. And now we've had George Washington. Oh, and we had Abraham Lincoln.
Yep.
Avoid foreign entanglements and unnecessary alliances.
What are we, Han Solo?
Imperial entanglements. Where are you finding that one? Where was that?
It's
right,
below,
just
yeah, below,
after
oh, just,
George Washington.
Oh,
George.
Yeah.
We affirm the wisdom of President George Washington's warning to avoid foreign entanglements and unnecessary alliances.
Get out of Saudi Arabia.
We therefore oppose the adoption or ratification of treaties that would weaken or encroach upon American sovereignty, or that could be construed by courts to do so.
Or like the Geneva Convention.
Uh-huh. Or some of our NATO defense agreements.
Yep.
Which is
Thank
something...
you, Trump, for coming out and stating exactly what he stated, but we'll get into that later.
Yeah.
So what I love is, first column at the top, They actually state something. Our most urgent task as a party is to restore the American people's faith in their government by electing a president who will enforce duly enacted laws, honor constitutional limits on executive authority, and return credibility to the Oval Office. First column, first paragraph.
Yeah. There it is. Wow.
I saw that and went, uh-huh. An actual out-and-out statement.
Well, here's another out-and-out statement, though. We will not recognize as binding upon the United States any international agreement forged without the constitutionally required assent of two-thirds of the United States Senate.
So any form of agreement about, say one of our favorite things, clean air.
Anything that's done through the State Department.
Yeah.
That's an overreach.
Yeah.
Foreign policy matters are the executive branch.
Yep, so this is also the party of states' rights as well.
Yeah.
Drawing the queer battle lines of this is why you're going to fight in the next American Civil War.
Mm. Yeah, it's just going to be a party war.
This is what you're fighting for.
We have administrative law as the next section, but it's the one after it that you're probably going to love, Andy.
Okay. Well, anything in administrative law? Probably.
Unelected bureaucrats. They're speaking out against the czars that have been used forever.
Even though that was started by
Bush 1.
By Reagan.
Oh, Reagan.
No, the first czar was Reagan.
Neat.
Unelected bureaucrats in the executive branch now write countless rules with the force of law and arbitrarily punish individuals who disobey those rules.
They don't arbitrarily punish. They very specifically punish based on the laws that are in place.
And they're seeing that as a government overreach from the executive branch.
Because, by God, they don't want people to be able to drink their water.
Well, everything that comes from the executive branch of the federal government is considered overreach by them because it encroaches on states' rights.
Well, no, beyond that, let's get into truth where it has been, at least the way I've seen it for the last 8 years.
Well, they don't really want...
Specifically, it's because it's a Democrat in charge.
They don't because there's a black man in charge.
They don't want Trump to have power either. I mean,
that's true.
Let's think about this. If they put a President Trump in there as the ultra wild card that he is, they can't trust him because he's gone against things that he already said that he was going to do for them or to them or whatever. He has a price, obviously. So they can't trust him in that office, but he's the one that they've got. So they're going to put him in there. Should they win, which sadly it is still a possibility. We've got enough people in this country that are of that mindset and do vote. They don't want him to be able to do these executive orders either. So it is in their best interest right now to also restrict the executive branch whenever possible because they've also got hold of the Senate and they've got the House. They've got the legislative branch right now, and they're hoping to keep it, and they very well may because they're
gerrymandered.
They've
death.
Done really well at holding the lower legislative positions.
There was an interesting theory on the radio the other day where they're like, what if the GOP wants to intentionally lose this election? What if their goal is not to win? Because if they win the presidency, then they lose basically, historically, whoever's in the presidency ultimately loses the House and Senate.
Not always.
Typically.
Yeah.
Not always, but typically.
But that's also typical when there's a shift. So when you're going from a Democrat in the White House to a Republican in the White House, it's usually because there's been such unrest, you know, so much distaste that the voting switches over to the other party because of the hatred there.
Mm-hmm.
With this, we're so ultra polarized that, you know, there's no flippity flop. It's just no. No, I'm going to be over here and you're going to be over there. You know, the sway is not as it's not as predictable in that way. And Obama has a higher approval rating. He has a much higher approval rating than the House does. Way higher. But he's also the black man in the White House.
Yep.
Yeah, I won't repeat some of the words and sayings that I've heard about that.
Yeah. Mama Van states that, hasn't Trump stated that he will let Pence run the show while he does whatever? And that has been alluded to.
Trump has basically said he only wants to be president to do the cool things, and basically anything he finds boring, he will literally just relegate to other people.
Yeah, he's just going to delegate it out to other people. Yeah. You know, the same thing that he does with his business. He thinks he can get away with that as being president.
Yeah.
He's going to CEO the country. Yeah.
Well, the good news is if he gets in and tries that, he'll probably be impeached inside before the first term's done.
Could you see Melania Trump trying to do, like, an outreach with kids and nutrition?
No.
Could you see that? I can't see that.
But she'd be trending with the porn stars.
Can you imagine the parody porns that are going to be out there? Oh, I bet it's already there.
Yeah.
Rule 34.
Yeah. It's not there yet. They're working on it already.
Okay. So that was administrative law. And it's,
yeah. Now we get back to an oldie but goldie.
Defending marriage against an activist judiciary. So, yeah. Do you have friends that are gay? Do you have friends that like people of the same gender that they are, and that have fallen in love with people that they're the same gender they are? Or perhaps they're gender fluid and questioning, not quite going with the normal, I'm a man, macho, 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 or I'm a woman, feminine, you know, pretty princess style. You know, anything that is against the norm. Do you have those friends? I bet you do. I bet you do. I have many. They are legion. And I want them to be happy because I'm their friend.
I want them to not be persecuted.
Yeah. I want them
to... It doesn't matter that I'm... You know,
I just want them to be happy.
Or not. I want them to not be persecuted because persecution's wrong.
Yeah. There is that. There is certainly that. I personally just want them to be happy. And by taking away their ability to fulfill their relationships in the traditional ways that relationships are fulfilled, you denigrate them as people. You make them unhappy.
You know,
why are you doing that?
Just to throw this out there, if consenting adults decide that they get together and there's going to be three or four of them, I don't even care about that.
Yeah, I'm not against that either. I'm against it only...
We can work out the tax code.
Yeah, I'm only against it if there is force involved. If everybody is perfectly happy with it, you know, the sister wife things, or, you know, who the brother husbands or whatever, I don't care. You know, that's possible too. You could have multiple husbands. You could have multiple wives. I don't care.
If you want to live in a binding sexual commune of no less than 32 people with a prescribed penis length minimum, I don't care as long as it's all consensual.
As long as it's consensual, I don't want to be in your bedroom.
I might not agree to it, but if it's consensual, feel free.
Yeah, well... Let me take that back. I might want to be in your bedroom, but I don't want to regulate what's going on in your bedroom. I just want everybody to be legal. You know, don't force people to do things they don't want to do.
What I love, though, is in this section, the wording they use, that, you know, they condemn the Supreme Court's ruling in United States v. Windsor.
Yeah.
And the big one that came out was the Obergefell versus Hodges. Yeah, no, I love this. In Obergefell, five unelected lawyers robbed 320 million Americans of their legitimate constitutional authority to define marriage as a union of one man and one woman. Please, anyone out there who's listening now, who's listening when this is, goes out, please write us and tell me how gay people being able to be married has somehow robbed you of your ability to define your marriage.
I don't understand this at all.
I've got the perfect answer for you. If the ability to gay people to marry ruins your marriage, one of you is gay.
Yeah.
Or you're doing marriage wrong.
But it's just that wording. Really. I go, really? Plus, of 320 million Americans, they're accounting most of the American population. They're trying to do all the American population. I think they're missing the fact that they're also including the gay community and all the other communities in there. In that
and all
number.
The allies of those people.
Mm-hmm. They don't think gay because people actually exist.
I want to say there's at least 50-some million people who vote regularly we can take out of that who don't believe that we should have constitutional authority to define marriage as a union of one man and one woman.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. This alone, this little section of their party platform, if you are gay or if you are an ally, I would like to know how you could also still believe in this party platform. If you are a Republican, you state that you're a Republican, you vote Republican, and you also maybe are gay. How do you reconcile those two? I can't see it.
That's because you're not suffering from the same levels of cognitive dissonance required.
That's true. I'm not. But I really encourage anybody, think about that. This is what the party is. This is one of the pillars of their foundation here. They're very proud of it.
Well, the reason they can get away with this is because...
because it's
people
the
say,
tyranny of,
people
of the majority.
People say, I'm a Republican, as though it's like being part of a sports team.
Yeah. You supplanting know. The ego and id.
I'm a New York Mets fan. I'm a New York Jets fan. I'm a San Francisco 49ers fan.
But do they
I'm a
know,
Republican.
But do they know what it means?
No concept of what the difference is between those types of associations.
Well, again, it's the same thing, like, and I love Samuel Clemens, aka Mark Twain's thing, of the best cure for a Christian is to read the Bible. And I'm a Christian. Okay, well, have you read all of these things? You say this is your book, your holy book, you believe everything in it. Flip to page. What about this verse?
Do you know what Samuel Clemens said about the Book of Mormon?
What's that?
Chloroform in print.
Ooh,
and a
apply
cure
cold water to the burn.
Mm-hmm. Chloroform in print. So the under the First Amendment, religious liberty, they also call out George Washington and Thomas Jefferson.
However, they also mess up the quote, or they don't complete it properly.
Of course, religion and morality are indispensable supports to a free society. Yeah, I don't think that's not the full quote.
That's obviously not the full quote because they complete it after they end the quote.
What gets me is the whole thing with Thomas Jefferson because you've read the same book I have. And the quote they have here with Thomas Jefferson, he said, declared that, quote, no provision in our Constitution ought to be dearer to man than that which protects the rights of conscience against the enterprises of the civil authority. He was also the one who said there ought to be an eternal wall of separation.
Yeah.
Between church and state.
Yep.
AKA, your religion should not affect the law, and the law should not affect your religion. They need to be separate.
Yeah, how many times do we have to say that? I mean, really? Oh, and I love when they say, no, it's a one-way wall. That only means that that government can't interfere with the church. It's
yeah, no.
What? That's not how this works. It's not how any of this works. Okay, so let's see. Ongoing attempts to compel individual businesses and institutions of faith to transgress their beliefs are part of a misguided effort to undermine religion and drive it from the public square. You have churches. You don't need a public square.
Also, the book specifically, the Bible specifically states, I believe it is Mark 25, that as a Christian, you are not supposed to pray in public.
That is stated, yes.
Going down further in the second paragraph.
Oh, wait, hang on.
Pledge to defend... Oh, go ahead.
Republicans believe the federal government, specifically the IRS, it's constitutionally prohibited from policing or censoring speech based on religious convictions or beliefs, and therefore we urge the repeal of the Johnson Amendment.
Oh, no, I agree. Censoring speech based on religious conviction, it's fine. That's part of freedom of speech. You're allowed to speak all you want. Mm-hmm. Acting on said things is problematic. And I'm echoing.
You're not echoing on this side. So
he's echoing to me.
It's not coming through this recording. So if I'm not hearing it, then it shouldn't be going out to other people. So don't worry, it's just Google Hangouts doing Google Hangouts things.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Places of worship for the first time in our history have reason to fear the loss of tax-exempt status merely for espousing and practicing traditional religious beliefs that have been held across the world for thousands of years and for almost four centuries in America.
Let's also make it the statement that in only America is religious organizations tax exempt. In every other country, they aren't.
Yeah.
And then the only one that it is the Vatican, but that's 108 acres.
It is also the government.
Yeah.
The Vatican City is its own country.
Yep.
So it does not count.
I love how they're trying to cover themselves with this. We pledge to defend the religious beliefs and rights of conscience of all Americans to safeguard religious institutions against government control. Yet when we see a Satanist attempt to do and request to do a thing on the lawn or to do or pass out literature or to do an invocation at a city council meeting, yeah, so they're not really wanting to defend that person's religious beliefs and rights of conscience.
We endorse the First Amendment Defense Act, which is Republican legislation in the House and Senate, which will bar government discrimination against individuals and businesses for acting on the belief that marriage is the union of one man and one woman. This act would protect the nonprofits' tax status of faith-based adoption agencies, the accreditation of religious education institutions, the grants and contracts of faith-based charities and small businesses, and the licensing of religious professions, all of which are under assault by elements of the Democratic Party.
Oh, so that's completely unrelated things in a slippery slope argument all rolled into one.
Well, yep. Remember... Dr. Sleepy, he did call out that Hillary Clinton and the Democratic Party are the enemy.
Yeah.
And from his very Seventh-day Adventist position, that means Satan.
Well, no, specifically, Dr. Sleepy also said that Hillary was connected to Lucifer.
Yeah. But the enemy, that's code for
the devil.
The devil.
I read that a different way based on my readings of various boards.
Even when he said Lucifer boards
and things of that nature, Republicans tend to view as the hardcore Tea Party Republicans especially view liberals as a existential threat to the country.
Oh yeah.
And people that should, they consider liberals people that should be tried for treason for espousing the beliefs that they do.
Well, I was specifically referring to the religious
Dr.
element.
Sleepy's comment that, you know, the Democratic Party is the enemy, mm-hmm. as basically code for get ready to fight these guys.
yeah.
Yeah, but he's not the NRA guy. He's the religious freedom guy.
Yeah, he's close to the evangelical crowd.
Yeah, he was speaking specifically to the evangelical crowd, which is why he mentioned Lucifer.
Yeah, capital E.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, not the small E.
Yeah, the enemy. So, but no, you're right. It's duplicitous. It works both ways.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we are. But
he might have a different intent in mind.
As a religion.
As a religion. The ultra religious crowd, yeah. There is still those murmurings of Democrats are the enemy. Liberals are the yeah. enemy.
And certainly, it's an existential threat because it's not really an enemy.
Oh, I've been practically accused my face of being possessed by a demon of liberalism.
The demon of liberalism.
Yes.
That's entertainment right there.
Oh, it was hilarious. I couldn't stop laughing for a day.
What is the name of this demon? You should call it out and rebuke it.
Clearly.
Please. I would love to see that exorcism. Love it.
They have to start reading to me from the fountainhead?
Oh, jeez.
Wow.
Yep.
Oh, and Rand. Oh, my gosh. Oh, okay.
The
okay.
power of Rand compels you. And it has to be written
by Who is
Rand
John
Paul.
Galt? Who is John Galt? Who is John Galt? Oh, okay. Okay. That's oh, above. That's humor that not everybody's going to get.
Read, people. Read. Unfortunately, you won't necessarily be better for it.
No, but...
Not that book, at least.
No. I've read worse books. I will say that.
Yeah, I've read the Turner Diaries.
Why did you do that?
So I can laugh at people who believe it.
Okay. Wow. All right. So then they start going into specific amendment issues, First Amendment, Second Amendment. Oh, the Second Amendment. I suppose we should touch on that, since that's something that we've also had a special on within the last couple weeks.
And with everything that's still going on in the world, and we can't go a week without a shooting?
Apparently not. Yeah.
Whoa. First Amendment's fun.
What would you see in the First Amendment?
Freedom of speech includes the right to devote resources to whatever cause or candidate one supports. Money is free speech.
That's right up top,
front center. Let's get it out there.
So that what I stated was in the preamble. There it is.
We pose any restrictions in clear language that would discourage citizens from participating in the public square or limit their ability to promote their ideas. Hmm. However, as requiring private organizations to publicly disclose their donors to the government.
However, the very
what?
End...
So no disclosure. No, you don't need to do that.
No, except go to the very end where they pull another Thomas Jefferson quote.
Okay, yes. We agree with Thomas Jefferson that, quote, to compel a man to furnish contributions of money for the propagation of opinions which he disbelieves and abhors is sinful and tyrannical. Okay, so I don't want my tax dollars used for that.
Yeah.
That would be sinful and
it goes
tyrannical.
Directly against
that
everything in the first thing, unless, of course, you absolutely believe that all this.
Should have brought the fireball in here.
Raising or repealing contribution limits. Protecting the political speech of advocacy groups, corporations, and labor unions, and protecting political speech on the internet. We likewise call for an end of the so-called fairness doctrine and support free market approaches to free speech unregulated by government.
Ah, neat. Does that mean they're going to get rid of all the censorship laws?
That's,
No, that's not what they mean.
That's not what they mean, but that is what they say. That's what that says. Liberty, liberty, liberty. Liberty, my liberty, not your liberty. My liberty, liberty, liberty. God.
America.
Okay. God, America.
Bless you.
God, America. Okay, the Second Amendment, our right to keep and bear arms, we uphold. the right of individuals to keep and bear arms, a natural inalienable right that predates the Constitution and is secured by the Second Amendment. Lawful gun ownership enables Americans to exercise their God-given right of self-defense for the safety of their homes, their loved ones, and their communities.
All I know is next time I play a game, I want my character's alignment to be lawful gun.
Lawful gun? Nice. Where? How is that a God-given right? I don't remember seeing that anywhere.
Also, the right to bear arms predates the Constitution? No,
not
doesn't.
In any way. Not in any way. I actually
almost
had
all armies were conscript armies back in the day, and your weapons were kept at essentially an armory when you were not out in the field.
There's I found a document. I'm going to have to find it and I'll post it. But it was an analysis essay at a university about the Second Amendment. And he went into the history of when arms were brought in, and the right was of white landowners. They could have a weapon for hunting and defense. No one else was allowed to have one. That was pre-Constitution. That was colonial days.
Back in the day where, at least in this country, you had to worry about literally the really pissed off natives coming and burning your house down and killing you because you were on their land and may have done the same to them.
Yeah, there is that. There certainly is that. I will find that. It is posted somewhere on my personal wall.
Yeah, put that in there because I want to read that.
It's long and super detailed, and it really rips into it. And it was all about, you know, the formation of the language. Because, as we've stated, it's one sentence. The Second Amendment is one sentence. And the comma placement, that's the thing.
Yep.
You know, Mama Van, that's a good question. Was this party platform written by a Dominionist?
Actually, as Andy would actually agree with this, I will keep repeating that book, The Court and the Cross. Read it. More than likely, yes. Or at least there were Dominionists working on it.
There are influences here. You might be asking, what's a Dominionist? Dominionism. Ted Cruz's father is a Dominionist. I will look up that really quickly.
Quick little thing from Dominion Theology on Wikipedia.
Oh, thank you.
Dominion Theology is a grouping of theocratic ideologies that seek to institute a nation governed by Christians based on understanding the biblical law. Extensive rule and ways of achieving governing authority are varied. For example, Dominion Theology can include theonomy, but does not necessarily involve advocating Mosaic law as the basis of government. This label is primarily applied toward groups of Protestants in the United States. So it's basically they want to create a true theocratic government based on their interpretation of biblical law.
Christian Sharia.
Yeah.
There you go. Christian Sharia. And yeah. Yeah. This is kind of what this reads like. I know. I'm scared too. Okay. So,
seeing how open they are in the Second Amendment section?
Yeah.
Halfway down, three-quarters way down, there's a, we support constitutional carry statutes and salute the states that have passed them, except in a state with an open carry law, they made it illegal for people to open carry around the convention.
They had major restrictions on what was allowed in. People weren't allowed to bring signs in. Recording devices. I mean, it was rough.
I love that the true
specifically
utter
tomatoes
pinpoint hypocrisy right there.
Yeah. We support firearm reciprocity legislation to recognize the right of law-abiding Americans to carry firearms to protect themselves and their family in all 50 states. Nah.
Reciprocity is a fancy word for revenge, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
It's, well, yes and no. It can be give and take. In this way, it's revenge. But in truth, it just means give and take.
Oh, okay, okay. And we oppose ill-conceived laws that would restrict magazine capacity or ban the sale of the most popular and common modern rifle.
AR-15.
Or that SIG MCX that was used at Pulse.
Yeah. The SIG MCX is an AR-15 platform.
I know.
Yeah.
I know. But that was the particular weapon used. It looks just like it. I know. In fact, it's a little bit lighter. But yeah. Oh, we also oppose any effort to deprive individuals of their right to keep and bear arms without due process. So this section was completely written by the NRA.
Yeah, especially when you get completely. Down to the next section, third sentence.
Let's see. So which one? We call for a thorough investigation.
No, that's fourth sentence. We oppose federal licensing or registration of law-abiding gun owners, registration of ammunition, and restoration of the ill-fated Clinton gun ban.
We call for a thorough investigation by a new Republican administration of the deadly Fast and Furious operation.
Which was headed up, thought up by, and executed by Republicans.
Yeah.
It just happened to be under a Democratic president, but everyone...
That is literally a call for a lynch mob to get the black man.
Yeah, it was under Daryl Issa. Look him up if he's in the Congress. It was his operation, and he's a hardcore Republican.
So, Fourth Amendment. Reaffirming the Fourth Amendment right of the people to be secure in their houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. We call for strict limitations on the use of aerial surveillance on U.S. soil and the exception of patrolling our national borders for illegal entry and activity. We oppose any attempts by government to require surveillance devices in our modern lives, including tracking devices in motor vehicles. Hey, you know what? I'm cool with that.
Except we know the truth of this. This will be thrown out. This will be just stepped over and forgotten about because
yeah.
We have to get the terrorists.
Yeah, exactly.
We have to get the terrorists. Plus, it's going to, you know.
Fear trumps the liberty argument.
This is going to destroy the ability of anybody to do house arrest.
Wouldn't?
Mama Van put in the chat room, wasn't the Brady Bill or Reagan thing, or am I off on that? Unfortunately, you are off on that, but only slightly. It was actually done in 94. So it was end of Bush era.
But Brady was shot during the Reagan administration, so.
That's when it first started to be brought in. It didn't get passed until 94.
Yeah. So. There is encrypted information. There it is. It will not be easy to balance privacy rights with the government's legitimate need to access encrypted information. This issue is too important to be left to the courts. A Republican president and a Republican Congress must listen to the American people and forge a consensus solution. Okay. But they don't know what encryption does.
Yeah. But it's a great word to throw in there.
Yeah, because it's scary. Basically, this is... remember that stuff we said about protecting your privacy and...
Yeah, these increased...
from illegal searches and seizures.
These increased privacy protections have become crucial to the digital economy. At the same time, however, such innovations have brought new dangers, especially from criminals and terrorists who seek to use encryption technology to harm us.
Yeah, so forget about all that protection of your personal liberty and rights. We got to see what's in your emails.
But also, let's go, as I bring my terrorism experience onto this, let's bring the more truth into this and realize, no, that's actually... As much as they use it, that's actually entirely false to a degree, because the best ways that the terrorist groups have figured out to defeat us is to go to hand-passed notes and not use any technology whatsoever that can be tracked or captured.
Yeah, offline.
Sneaker net.
Dead drop, I believe, is what it's called. Many cases. Mm-hmm. Yeah, old spycraft still works.
Oh, yeah.
Because most of us have forgotten it because we've gone all digital. Yeah. We've had to rebuild it.
Yep. Most of the, like, I guess it was the Boston Marathon bombings. That was orchestrated by SMS. All in the clear.
Mm-hmm.
There was no encryption involved. And no one's going to get rid of SMS. It's like, are you sure? That's just not going to happen.
Or again, the laundering money to terrorist organizations by, what are you doing? And my actual teacher I had in a terrorism class said he actually watched one of these operations. They were contacting a cousin they had in the Middle East or one of the areas there and were buying like 50 or 100 washing machines.
Wiring
the money to purchase these washing machines.
Washing machines. Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. How can you tell? How can you tell? Oh, it's easy, really, to get away with a lot of this stuff. There's just too much. There's too much. It's a complex world. Okay. So yeah, they're up for privacy. They like the Fourth Amendment, but they understand that it's going to be a difficult balancing act. This is true. It is a difficult balancing act because of the way they want to do things. I really hope that they actually look up what encryption means, how the math works, and what I've noticed is that the Congress critters that we have up there, they just need to be informed about these things. They need a little bit of education, and then the technology becomes clear. All these things, they then understand. But you have to walk them through the understanding first. Otherwise, they will get caught up in the same headline mentality, too. It's a bad idea because of this, because of X, because of Y. Not thinking about all the other little connective tissue that makes these things work and the knockdown effects.
I don't think that they want to understand it. They just...
There are some. Yeah, there are some that don't.
There's a lot that don't. They don't need to understand it. All they need to do is make sure that they have a line which pulls well with the focus groups and gets them the votes that they need to maintain power.
Yeah,
and
they
this will do that.
They obfuscate the actual meat of the issue.
Because people don't understand encryption either. Most people don't use it, have no idea what it's used for, why it might be important for them to use.
Mm-hmm.
They have no idea.
Yeah, encrypt all the things, people. Encrypt all the things. And if you want to know anything about it, then follow our show. Share the show with other people, and we'll eventually talk them through it one way or another. Or, you know, shoot us an email. I'll get back to you. I'll tell you. Okay, so we are a third through this document at this point. So I think we need to hustle it along a bit.
Yeah, the next one, the Fifth Amendment, is going to be an interesting one.
Okay, Fifth Amendment, protecting human life. So this would be the anti-abortion. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah. Which, again, reading the actual Fifth Amendment, you talk about finding a way to manipulate the meaning of something and twisting it. Yeah. For those who don't know out there,
be deprived
the
of life, liberty, or property.
The actual Fifth Amendment is thus. No person shall be held to answer for a capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on a presentiment or indictment of a grand jury, except in cases arising in the land or naval forces or in the militia when in actual service in a time of war or public danger, nor shall any person be subject for the same offense to be twice put in jeopardy of life or limb, nor shall be compelled in any criminal case to be a witness against himself, nor be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law, nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation.
So they go in, so that was the, quote, protecting human life section here. You know, they address the Fifth Amendment three times. So there's protecting human life, then there's protecting private property, and then there's intellectual property rights. They're lumping all those into the Fifth Amendment, which is interesting. Forwarding down here, though,
Peter Tischel from Alexa.
Right in the big middle. The Democratic Party is extreme on abortion. Democrats almost limitless support for abortion and their strident opposition to even the most basic restrictions on abortion put them dramatically out of step with the American people.
Which every poll shows that is entirely 100% incorrect.
It shows that they're dramatically out of step with the Republican Party because they're the Democratic Party. And that's how these things work.
Red versus blue.
It is red versus blue. I think we can move along from that. Basically, they are pro-life, life, 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 life. Anti-abortion, abortion, abortion.
In all cases.
In all cases. In absolutely all cases. Protecting private property. Amendment declares that private property may not be taken for public use without just compensation. The Supreme Court's Clio decision undermined this safeguard. They are just attacking the hell out of the Supreme Court.
This is a shot against the Bureau of Land Management.
Yeah. State Constitution Amendment declaring that private property...
Most people don't know what the BLM is, does the history of how it came into being, or why most of the states out west don't own most of their own land.
Yeah. I have a podcast again. I'm sorry. Well, hey Sprocket. Yes.
And Clio itself was about eminent domain, transferring from one private owner to another.
Hmm. Okay, well, this again.
Here, they actually assess civil asset forfeiture.
Yeah, there it is.
Interesting.
As a way to cripple organized crime. Yeah, we've talked about civil asset forfeiture too. There was also a segment on Last Week Tonight, where John Oliver went on about that as well.
So look, a section of this thing I can actually agree with.
Yeah.
Their section on civil asset forfeiture. Because they're against it. I'm like, I agree completely.
Mm-hmm. I'm kind of against the whole eminent domain thing, too. But since they are supposed to do just compensation, okay, fine. Yeah. But that's market value. That's not taking into account any sweat equity and emotional value behind things. And
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because honestly, you can't really put a price to that, in truth.
Yeah, but also,
it's objective.
It's land in the country. You have a right to it. So, but it's still within the entire country borders. So, yeah, it's not really yours. Yeah, yeah. Just like the house that you have a mortgage on, it's not really yours. It's the bank's house that you're paying them rent for. Up to a certain amount, it's a rent to own opportunity.
Yep.
Then intellectual property rights. Private property includes not only physical property such as lands and homes, but also intellectual property like books and patents. By protecting property rights of creators and innovators, the Constitution promotes the general welfare by providing incentives for investment of all sorts of technology and artistic works, intellectual property, blah, 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 blah. Okay. What are you
talking
about?
I'm kind of agreeing with what you're saying here. They're basically going, protecting intellectual property is also a national security issue. We must guard against counterfeit parts that can compromise the reliability of our weapon systems and the safety of military personnel. Today, the worst offenders against intellectual property rights come from abroad, especially in China. We call for strong action by Congress and a new Republican president to enforce intellectual property laws against all infringers, whether foreign or domestic. I can kind of get behind that, but I also understand the actual global economic problems and legal problems of that. That's, hi, here's our law. We're now going to enforce it in your country against your citizens.
Yeah.
Isn't that something that they specifically ramble on about not wanting to have happen here?
Yes,
no,
it
was. They're allowed to do it over there. They're not allowed to do it here.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah, yeah. NIMBY, not in my backyard.
Yep.
We'll keep it in yours.
Yeah, yeah. And then we move on to the Ninth Amendment, the people's retained rights. Ninth Amendment of the Constitution declares that the enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. This provision codifies the principle that our national government derives its power from the governed and that all power not delegated to the government are retained by the people. We call upon legislators to give full force to this fundamental principle. We welcome to our ranks all citizens who are determined to reclaim the rights of the people that have been ignored or usurped by the federal and intrusive state governments. So they're all about states' rights, but apparently state governments are also very intrusive.
That's also a very long paragraph
that says
that
nothing.
Pretty much nothing.
It says nothing. They have no call for that at all. Okay. That's nice. I think this is the libertarian position. I think this is just courting
this
libertarians.
This is states' rights and individual rights over federal, having a federal government in the first place.
Then they get to the 10th Amendment section.
10th Amendment, federalism as the foundation of personal liberty. Federalism is a cornerstone of our constitutional system. Every violation of state sovereignty by federal officials is not merely a transgression of one unit of government against another, it is an assault on the liberties of individual Americans. Okay. What's the point? What's the point? Okay, down with big government. Big government undermines federalism through more than 1,100 grants in aid programs that consume more than one-sixth of the federal budget for matters that should be exclusive responsibilities of the states. So again, states' rights, big government bad, let's push
federalism
down. Yeah.
They keep using that word. I do not think it means what they think it means.
No, they're conflating two different terminologies.
Yeah. Good, because grant and aids are actually good. Usually.
Oh, wait a second. Including bullying of state local governments in matters ranging from voter identification laws to immigration and health care to land use decisions and from forced education curricula to restroom policies.
So, if you want to discriminate somebody with voter ID, that's perfectly fine. We're okay with that because we don't want the government telling you can't do that. If you want to say people can't live there, that's fine. If you want to, you know,
and
have
the transgender
bad health
bathrooms.
Care, sure. And land use decisions, that right there is part of, yeah, I want to, as a corporation, mm-hmm. be able to pollute the hell out of things to make money. But also that is a direct shot there, I can say, is against the Bureau of Land Management. To give an idea, the whole Cliven Bundy thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Is that right there, land use decision.
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, yeah. Forced education curricula, a.k.a. we're not allowing you to teach creationism in schools. It's evolution because science says yes.
And Common Core.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, of course, school restroom policies because I don't want my daughter to have to go to the bathroom with your son. I don't care if your son thinks he's a girl.
Yeah, all that. So they're conflating all of that under the 10th Amendment. So they think all of that is a constitutional issue.
Yep.
Okay. Honest elections and the Electoral College.
Honest Electoral College.
We oppose the National Popular Vote Interstate Compact and any other scheme to abolish or distort the procedures of the Electoral College. Basically, no.
They are hardcore supporters of
the
Electoral
College. We are keeping the Electoral College because it keeps us in power.
It's the exact purpose the Electoral College was created in the first place. It keeps the masses from being able to tear down the people at the top.
And, you know, the way that our elections are done is not... That's not really codified into the Constitution, is it?
No.
The way that we do it is not. That's just something that we've come up with. The party systems.
From state to state and sometimes from county to county.
Yeah, the party systems, that's not part of the whole thing either. That's something that has been made up as we've gone along. So it's the illusion of control. So they don't want to change the way elections are run. They like them just the way they are.
Which you'd think, given the fact of, as we've said, over the last 30 or 40 years, they've lost every presidential election. They didn't have a Bush in it. You'd think they'd want to change at this point.
Yeah. Honest elections are the foundation of representative government. We pledge to protect the voting rights of every citizen, as well as their rights of conscience, when they are harassed or denied a job because of their contributions to a candidate or a cause.
Has there actually been any evidence that this has happened?
Well, there was somebody that would not provide a toe to somebody with a Bernie sticker.
Ah. That wasn't a job, though.
Typically when somebody's denied a job, it's because of their color, sexual preference, or religious creed.
Yeah, the other protected classes.
Those are the cases where it is wrong to deny a person a job, where people are denied jobs precisely because of those things. Or age. Forgot to throw in age.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I love the wording here.
Okay, which one?
The next sentence. We support state efforts to ensure ballot access for the elderly, the handicapped, military personnel, and all legitimate voters.
Yeah. That legitimacy thing. Yeah.
A.K.A., or to read the subtext, people who are not black.
No, in this case, it's people who are Republicans.
Which are... It's basically the same thing.
They also completely want everyone to have a secure photo ID when voting.
Yep.
As soon as you get any form of ID, be it a state ID for anything else, be it a driver's license, you are automatically given one, and you register right then and there. Done.
It disproportionately affects minorities.
Yep, it does.
Which is why I say, subtext, this is to keep the black people from voting because we don't want them to vote if they vote 12-1 for Democrats. Actual quote.
Yeah. Now I don't mind this part here. We urge that electronic voting systems have a voter verified paper audit trail. We urge every state to join the Interstate Voter Registration Cross-Check program to keep voter rolls accurate and to prevent people from voting in more than one state in the same election. Okay, fine.
Which, they don't really have a problem with that.
Yeah.
In truth, there's been no real issues with that.
That it's just a non-issue?
Yeah. The idea of they bring up, oh my God, look at all this voter fraud that's occurring. Voter fraud, your vote won't count.
It's an illusion.
And like the last election, the actual last national election we had, I think there were a case of maybe across the entire United States, I think, 12 actual verified cases, of which 4 actually had enough evidence to go to trial.
It's way more effective to just prevent the other side from being able to vote. More effective.
Under the guise of a problem which doesn't actually exist.
Exactly, exactly.
Oh, go to the sentence directly below that one.
To guard against foreign involvement in our elections, we call for vigilance regarding online credit card contributions to candidates and campaigns.
But doesn't that fly directly in the face of the...
Money is speech? Yeah, it does.
Money is speech, and you should not have to disclose where the money came from.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just saying, no, you have to disclose where it's coming from so we know it's not foreign.
That is in direct conflict with what they've already stated in their party platform. Yeah. Members of the armed forces must not be denied the basic rights. Okay, yeah, that's right. Yeah, please, definitely. Take care of our troops. Maybe sign a bill or two. How about that? That'd be great for the veterans. Decennial census. You know what I found interesting? Most other countries run 5-year sentences. censuses.
Sentences.
Yeah.
Yep.
I've been sentenced. Sentenced to a consensus to a, yeah.
I've been sentenced to a possible Trump presidency.
Okay. I think really we ought to do them more often.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
The 10-year. You can miss entire, you know, generations of kids. You know. It's...
Plus, populations move that fast nowadays.
Oh yeah, especially in Florida.
Continuing on with that, though, see, in order to preserve the principle of one person, one vote, we urge our elected representatives to ensure that citizenship, rather than mere residency, be made the basis for the appointment of representatives among the states. So, essentially, prove that you're a citizen every time we do a census.
Show us your papers.
Yep.
Wow.
I like the idea. I will say, I like the idea.
I don't.
However,
I don't like that idea at all.
I get where you're trying to head with this.
But have you
thought about the actual implementation?
Well, no. Let's look at the knockdown effects of this. Because census polls coming up with general populations work on things that benefit everyone that lives there. Not that is a legal resident there, that physically are there.
Good argument. Good counter argument.
So, okay. I mean, like roads. The population of Hialeah down in Miami is X. If you go with legal citizens, it's way smaller. Then why is there so much traffic on the roads? Well, your census population states this, so we can't justify having an 8-lane highway.
Good argument.
You know, I mean, there are knockdown effects. You can't separate it like that. You actually have to look at the reality of the situation, and this is not the reality of the situation. People are there.
If we had always checked for citizenship, and that was basically like the INS went along with them, and they had the authority to arrest and deport as they found people from like the beginning. That would be one thing, because we wouldn't have, you know, 11 to 16 million people living here who are not here legally.
Yeah.
Well, again, remember, most of those people who are not here legally were here legally.
People that are here illegally, if you really want to do something crazy, I don't know, change the sales tax rate. If you want to collect money from them, if it's a tax issue or something like that, change the sales tax rate. Because they buy things. Make a federal sales tax of 1%. You know, state sales tax, here in Florida, it's 7%. Maybe a little higher with half percentages or lower with half percentages elsewhere. So, okay, now the sales tax is 8% for Florida. 1% of that, of every single transaction, goes to the federal government. You then take effect of all the people that simply are there conducting commerce, whether they live there or not. They've paid sales tax.
I'd be in favor of that as long as that's included in the graduated tax rate. For example, the lowest income earners...
it'd be different.
All the way
it's a tariff.
Up into, partway into middle class income earners, essentially a tax rate of 0%, and they'll just get it through the sales tax. And then, basically from middle class up, graduated tax rates.
Or maybe since you're filing federal income tax, then there's just a little checkbox for where you live. That, you know, basically like the standard deduction, that just goes up and gives you some of that money back at the end of the year. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are ways to do this.
Oh, yeah.
Just leave them alone and let them contribute to the economy. They have to eat.
They're doing it already.
Yeah, they have to eat. They have to pay to buy gas. You know,
And let's face it, they're not the 1% of the 1%.
No. They are the ones keeping the economy liquid. They're the ones that are moving the capital through the system. They are the lifeblood. Us down here on the ground that buy things and contribute to the economy.
They're paying rent somewhere.
They are paying rent somewhere.
That means somebody who owns that property.
Yeah, there might be 20 of them there, but they are contributing to the economy.
If they own a property somewhere somehow, they're paying income tax or property tax on it.
Yeah. They are contributing to the economy. If you really think they're a burden on the economy, then figure out a way to get money from them even while they're illegal. You can do it. You're the federal government.
Yeah.
Get creative. You have plenty of tax laws to do it. It can be done. I just came up with one. Go ahead. Take it. Okay. So now we truly are just, you know, a third through. America's natural resources, agriculture, energy, and the environment. Just the preamble. We're just going to look at the preamble and then just this quick subsection. The bolded highlights. That's all we're going to look at because that's probably all that we need to look at, really.
Yeah, there's already a sentence in this one that gets my attention because of the words being used.
Yeah. We are the party of America's growers, producers. Oh, I have a cat digging into my shoulder. Okay. Oh, thank you, Podcat. Stay.
Acupuncture.
She's
practicing.
I need pauldrons. I need really big. Yeah, those little dew claws? Yeah, that's what he's digging in with now.
Hey, okay. I've got enough friends. I can probably make you some.
Oh, yeah, might need it. Okay. All right, we are the party of America's growers, producers, farmers, ranchers, foresters, miners, commercial fishermen, and all those who bring from the earth the crops, minerals, energy, and the bounties of our sea, our matey, that that are the lifeblood of our economy. Sorry, it's very piratey. Their labor and ingenuity, their determination in bad times and love of the land at all times powers our economy, creates millions of jobs, and feeds billions of people around the world.
Here we go.
Okay. Only a few years ago, a bipartisan consensus in government valued the role of extractive industries and rewarded their enterprise by minimizing its interference with their work. That has radically changed. We look in vain within the Democratic Party for leaders who will speak for the people of agriculture, energy, and mineral production.
Let me just go say this. Deepwater Horizon, all the spills around the Keystone XL fields, fracking, these are extractive industries, guys.
Yeah.
Never mind the sugar growers that are currently wreaking havoc in South Central Florida.
And have for over 100 years.
Yep.
And now instead of pumping it out to sea through a couple rivers, we're pumping it into the Everglades, which is going to cause immeasurable
harm. That's okay. Sea rise is polluting that with salt water anyways.
Yeah, there is some of that too, yeah. What is there to say about this? What is this? The summation of this section, we pledge to... No, that's the wrong
section.
This
is a shout-out to all of our farmer and giant corporation buddies.
Yeah, this isn't about the little guys. This is about the big, massive corporate farms. This is about, again, fracking industry, oil industry, everything else. This, literally, in a nutshell, is drill, baby, drill for all of those industries.
Yeah.
Let's get government regulation completely gone. We don't need to worry about that. Drill everything. Don't worry. We're not even going to care what happens. Spills, of course, they don't occur. Those are just a liberal conspiracy. You don't have to worry about any of that kind of stuff. Just go. Make your money.
Yeah, you're going to make everything more expensive with all your needless regulation. Just let the industry regulate itself, man. No.
Yep.
Because you've proven time and time again that you are bad stewards of your own industry. You mentioned Deepwater Horizon.
There's countless examples.
Yeah.
Countless.
I mean, that destroyed environments right along the Gulf Coast. Whole fishing industries. You know, the people that they stated that they're there to protect. Right here in the first first paragraph, they were the ones that were hurt because one of those companies didn't follow the regulations properly. But now they want to get rid of the regulations because those are the ones that are hurting you. It's the regulations. It's not the industry. Mm-hmm. I think we have several tangible examples of how that is incorrect. Okay.
As a quick read through, they do talk about the Army Corps of Engineers, the EPA's Waters of the United States rule. They do talk about the SNAP, also known as former food stamp mm-hmm. program. They do talk about the big data when it comes to agriculture and how it's a problem with public oversight and regulation that has created this. So there's a lot of, as Dan would say, there's a lot of meat in this section.
Yeah. Where they're probably going to be taking some meat off your table if you're not careful.
Yeah.
And then we're into a new era of energy. Our country has greater energy resources than any other place on Earth. I don't know if that's true.
Actually, Siberia has more oil.
Yeah, our engineers and miners, the men and women whose labor taps the forces of nature, are the best in the world. Again, I don't see any proof in that. But okay, it's definitely the nationalism argument and exceptionalism, American exceptionalism. Wait, what? What was that? Okay. Sorry, this sentence here just got my attention. We applaud congressional Republicans for doing just that through far-sighted legislation. Wait, what?
Their work can guarantee the nation's energy security for centuries to come if, instead of erecting roadblocks, government facilitates the creation of an all-of-the-above energy strategy.
All of the above. All energy matters.
Clean, affordable, secure, and abundant.
Literally ripping off Obama.
Oh, yeah. All energy matters. Oh,
our idea, guys.
And there's
totally our idea to go to Bureau of Land Management. Natural gas, power, and get everything in there. Get a smorgasbord, wind power, solar power.
Yeah, but with an emphasis on let's keep that coal going. Let's keep the oil coming and the fracking. Let's keep
we
all
need
that going.
Extractive industries to really just
we need to rape off. The planet. That's really what we need to do. We need
because that employs a lot of people working on a very few number of machines. Or what, is it the other way around?
It creates an awful lot of commodities that can be traded on the stock market.
Permitting for a safe, non-polluting hydroelectric facility, even one that is being relicensed, can take many years because of the current president's hostility to dams. The Keystone Pipeline has become a symbol of everything wrong with the current administration's ideological approach.
Wow. Now, I am in favor of our nuclear industry continuing.
Yeah.
I am in favor of that, but that also there's other things that go along with that and why we're not doing it. You know, the fear of basically Godzilla. That's really the fear. Okay. So we support the development of all forms of energy that are marketable in a free economy without subsidies, including coal, oil, natural gas, nuclear power, and hydropower.
I love the fact
Where's
that they
solar?
Include two words there, which make me go, really? Without subsidies.
Yeah.
Huh.
Okay, so remove the $8 billion a year we spend on the oil industry.
Yeah.
Nah.
Where's solar, though?
That's, I think, addressed in the first paragraph on that page. Government should not play favorites among energy producers.
Huh. Oh, you mean with, like, the oil subsidies?
Oh, yep. No.
Yeah.
Oh, second column top. We oppose any carbon tax.
Any carbon tax. That's because they don't think that we're actually doing climate change. Oh, I wonder when climate change is going to pop up here.
No, it's backwards. It's, see, the the carbon tax basically pushes people away from coal and oil production or usage.
Look at that.
Which hurts those lobby markets.
Climate change is far from this nation's most pressing national security issue, even though the Pentagon says it was.
Mm-hmm. Oh, also, we encourage the cost-effective development of renewable energy sources, wind, solar, biomass, biofuel, geothermal, and tidal energy, by private capital.
We don't want to pay for nothing.
That would upset the status quo.
Yeah.
Drill, baby, drill. And let's import more from Saudi Arabia.
I do like what it says at the bottom of this thing, that we support lifting restrictions to allow responsible development of nuclear energy, including research into alternative processes like thorium nuclear energy.
Hmm. Okay, good.
I'm actually pro-thorium reactors. They're actually, what I've seen drawn up, they're actually really cool. And of course, was it Chevrolet Chrysler had the thorium car?
I don't remember if they did or not. We respect the state's proven ability to regulate the use of hydraulic fracturing, methane emissions, and horizontal drilling. And we will
end the development of earthquake weaponry.
And we will end the administration's disregard of Nuclear Waste Policy Act with respect to long-term storage of nuclear waste. This is completely anti-environment.
Yep.
I can't know. Energy is both an economic and national security issue. We support the enactment of policies to increase domestic energy production, including production on public lands, to counter market manipulation by OPEC and other nationally owned oil companies. So we reduce America's vulnerability to energy price volatility.
Yeah, no, I'm in favor of subsidizing heavily into companies that are not producing energy from oil, so we can pretty much just say, yeah, we don't need that.
Yeah, yeah. You want to really counter market manipulation by OPEC? Come out, get out of the oil market.
Yeah.
Pick another form of energy and go with that.
Thanks, Mama Van. We will catch you next time. I'm sorry we are, of course, droning on, but this is something. This is the vegetables.
Good news. You can catch it when we get on YouTube.
Yeah, we... I do not anticipate doing a B show, honestly.
Yeah.
I do. This is
too much.
This is so much. So much. But this shows us what we're going to be up against for the next 4 or 8 years. At least four. Yeah. Until they have another convention, this is what we got.
Yep.
Or until there's a civil war.
Maybe both. Could be both. Why not both? Environmental progress.
One of the things on hold.
Their first sentence there, I'm questioning.
Conservation is inherent to conservatism.
Well, okay. Well, actually, no. That is actually technically.
That's technically
correct.
True.
That is technically correct.
But ideologically, it's not.
However, the current group of what people are calling themselves conservatives, no.
Yeah, that it's a play. It's just wordplay. That's all it is.
Oh, look, and God gets mentioned again.
Oh.
Conservation and let's utilize more resources are not
That's not
things
the same.
Which go hand in hand.
That's not the same, yeah.
Which you literally just talked about utilizing more of our own resources.
Wait, that's just wrong. We assert that private ownership has been the best guarantee of conscientious stewardship.
Yep. Just to think of how conscientious the stewardship of the beaches was when we let people build condos on all of them.
While some of the worst instances of degradation have occurred under government control, poverty, not wealth, is the gravest threat to the environment, while steady economic growth brings the technological advances which make environmental progress possible.
Oh my God, that is so tone deaf.
I think I'm bleeding from the ears.
Oh, wow.
I actually want to go grab food and drink.
I want to grab drink and food. I don't know how I'm going to do that. How do I food?
Gentlemen, we're about halfway through.
Yeah.
But also, we've been at it for a while. I think perhaps we should call it and maybe come back to it as a midweek episode.
I'm okay with that, only given my standard times I'm available. However, before we do that, look at the next sentence.
The environment is too important to be left to radical environmentalists. You mean the people that are trying to protect
the flip?
You mean the people? You mean the people that are trying to protect the environment?
It's too important to be left to people trying to protect. It's too important to be left to them.
I just need to flip a table somewhere.
The environmental establishment has become a self-serving elite stuck in the mindset of the 1970s, subordinating the public's consensus to the goals of the Democratic Party. That's a sentence.
Their approach is based on shoddy science, scare tactics, and centralized command and control regulation. Over the last 8 years, the administration has triggered an avalanche of regulation that wreaks havoc across our economy and yields minimal environmental benefits.
They're the enemy. They're an organized enemy. And we have to seize control from them.
The environmental establishment has become a self-serving elite. They are using yesterday's tools to control a future they do not comprehend.
The central fact
I can use that exactly that same sentence in regards to them.
The central fact of any sensible environmental policy is that year by year, the environment is improving. Our air and waterways are much healthier than they were a few decades ago. I wonder why?
Because we have regulations.
Because of those radical environmentalists who put in air quality regulations.
It's not because of kindness. Okay.
As a nation, we've drastically reduced pollution, mainstream recycling, educated the public, and avoided ecological degradation. Even if no additional controls are added, air pollution will continue to decline for the next several decades due to technological turnover of aging equipment.
Which was mandated by the Clean Air Act.
Yeah.
All right, whatever mythological table I flipped previously, it is now right again.
No, no, it's
flipped it twice.
He's flipped it twice.
So fast, it's perpetual motion.
Oh my God! Ah! Yeah.
Now's when the nose starts bleeding. I'm having a scanner's moment.
Yeah, all the veins have already popped out.
Brain is exiting head.
Okay, they just want to create jobs and destroy the environment. But they're not going to actually create any jobs. We propose to shift responsibility for environmental regulation from the federal bureaucracy to the states, and to transform the EPA into an independent bipartisan commission, similar to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. With structural safeguards against politicized science. Politicized science!
Yeah. Because it's not what they want. It's politicized.
Oh, that sound that you heard is me wanting to run for office and kill people. I'm sorry.
No, change things
for the better.
It's okay. It's okay, Andy. I'll just bring you in on my cabinet.
Oh, but David's already the chair of the table flipping. So I don't know what my position would be.
Clearly head of communications.
Oh.
You can operate the table shredder that I'm going to need by the time we've reached the end of this document.
Yes, yes, yes. Oh, my God.
The very last paragraph of this section states, "We firmly believe environmental problems are best solved by giving incentives for human ingenuity and the development of new technologies, not through top-down command and control regulations that stifle economic growth and cost thousands of jobs."
But by what?
That's just wrong.
I look at it and I go, that would be absolutely great if everybody in the United States was all about making everything better and not necessarily squeezing everything.
Oh, no.
Because we never had a history of people just throwing litter out on the highway.
There's a reason why your Big Mac box now comes in cardboard.
We reject the agendas of both the Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement, which represent only the personal commitments of their signatories. No such agreement can be binding upon the United States until it is submitted and ratified by the Senate. We demand an immediate halt to the U.S. funding for the U.N.'s Framework Convention on Climate Change in accordance with the 1994 Foreign Regulations Authorization Act. That law prohibits Washington from giving any money to any affiliation. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
They willingly want to destroy the environment.
Actually, yeah, no. That law prohibits Washington from giving any money to, quote, any affiliated organization of the United Nations, end quote, which grants Palestinians membership as a state. What?
So this is the pro-Israel argument, too.
That's also a random insert in there.
There is no ambiguity in that language. What?
Also, going back up, because again, we're getting pieces here.
Oh, my God.
First column, first main paragraph. There is certainly a need to protect certain species threatened worldwide with extinction. Worldwide's the key here. However, the Endangered Species Act should not include species such as gray wolves and other species if these species exist elsewhere in healthy numbers in another state or country.
So they don't care about localized environmental policy whatsoever.
No.
Just remember, if we do it correctly, don't worry, we can kill every single bald eagle in this country as long as there's some that exist in France.
In a healthy population.
Yeah.
Right. But
we
then
make sure they're somewhere else and we're good.
But then
wouldn't that be
the French bald eagle?
Hmm?
That'd be the French bald eagle then, not the American bald eagle.
Yep.
Oh, the Endangered Species Act should ensure that the listing of endangered species and the designation of critical habitats are based upon sound science and balance the protection of endangered species with the costs of compliance and the rights of property owners. No.
No, the endangered species come first. You can move.
I don't care if it costs you more money. That animal's going to go extinct.
Yeah.
They just, it's all money. Follow the money. If it costs them money, they're against it. If it makes them money, they're for it. Period.
Instead, over the last few decades, the ESA has stunted economic development, halted the construction of projects, burdened landowners, and has been used to pursue policy goals inconsistent with the ESA, all with little to no success in the actual recovery of a species.
That's baloney.
Bullshit.
Yeah, that's bullshit. We have
that's
many examples.
False.
We have so many examples.
Absolutely, provably false. For example, we oppose the listing of the lesser prairie chicken and the potential listing of the sage grouse. Neither species has been shown to be in actual danger, and the listing threatens to devastate farmers, ranchers, oil and gas production.
There you go.
Guys, actually look it up. For any listeners out there, actually look up what these species do, what they are, look from actual science sources, and you'll see that these are actually key species in the area that keep that section of the country healthy as an environment.
Yeah.
And no, they're not on it because their population has not dropped enough yet, but they're close. And it's the idea of we don't want to start caring when they hit there. We want to start caring and keep them from getting there. That's the point of all of this.
These are people that do not understand a food web.
These are people who don't understand the old adage of an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.
Yeah,
no, but Andy, why would you go hunting? Why would you go killing an animal when you could just go to a grocery store and buy it? And buy your meat then. That's the kind of thing I'm dealing with here. It's that kind of cognitive dissonance and abject stupidity. Because there's no other word for it, honestly. This is abject stupidity.
No, this is willful stupidity. They want to believe what they believe so that it benefits their pocketbook.
These are not 40K orcs, unfortunately, and can't make that an actual reality.
Oh.
I don't know. They're kind of trying.
Above, second column above where you have the We Reject the Agendas.
Yeah.
The United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is a political mechanism, not an unbiased scientific institution. Its unreliability is reflected in its intolerance towards scientists and others who dissent from its orthodoxy. We will evaluate its recommendations accordingly.
But that's not right.
Also, patently false.
Yeah.
And also, we will evaluate its recommendations accordingly. Why don't you just come out and say that you reject it?
Yeah, that's what they're saying. We just absolutely reject it. Not a problem.
No, no, no. Look, look, right here. Information concerning a changing climate, especially projections into long-range future, must be based on dispassionate analysis of hard data. So the fact that we care at all about it means that we're too passionate about it and biased. Therefore, well, we're obviously unbelievable about it.
Well, the other problem is, even when it's truly dispassionate analysis,
it can be dismissed. It, no matter what, they can dismiss it.
You're passionately being dispassionate.
Yeah. Okay. All
right. The table is in pieces.
Okay, so when we reconvene, it will be government reform. But at this point,
how do we want to try to do that is the question.
I don't know. Sometime, whenever we can get together this coming week would be.
Because I will say, I am, my schedule has changed.
Okay.
But my schedule has changed, not necessarily that great. If you want to do another late night show per se, but it might really hurt you, I'm free Wednesday, probably at like 11:30 p.m. Right now I have Sundays, not entirely free. Thursdays, somewhat free, and Fridays.
I could probably do Sunday.
I might be able to bring in Dan on that too.
David, how about you?
The problem is it would have to be. Well, no, we could do Sunday late. Dan would then be going to sleep, as per protocol.
I could probably do Sunday, but this would be a hard cutoff at about right now.
I think that's fine. So
about 9:30 Sunday.
Yeah. Same bad time, same bad channel.
Tune in, folks.
We'll see if we can chew through this. I am now going to do several shots of something, and try to not fall into a fetal position over the state.
I'm going to comfort eat a ton of ice cream and wash it down with Bailey's.
I'm going to attempt to read all of this.
Oh, you are a. You are a true.
Junkie. I am a political junkie, glutton. And this is meat and a bone for me to gnaw on for days.
But you were a glutton for punishment. Oh my!
Oh, you have no idea.
God, this is terrible.
I've only got 36 pages to go.
Oof. Better you than me, man.
Oh,
I'm
man.
Telling you.
And folks, we skimmed. You know, we read a lot. But we also skimmed. I still go out to our webpage, pull down the link. You'll see what we're seeing.
Or if that's too lazy for you, just go to Google, type RNC platform 2016.
No,
it'll be
no.
The first...
Go to our show notes. I need the traffic.
Better...
Go
to our show notes. We need the traffic. We need to show people that people are actually watching.
That's right. Go to the show notes. It's like, don't hurt me like that, man. Don't hurt me like that.
Sorry, it's not out there. We have the only link available. Just go through
That's
us.
Right. That's right. Just go through us. We've got it. We've got the source. Oh.
Yeah, this is painful.
It's so bad. It's so bad.
Again, it's.
I was looking for anything good, and all they did was hit me with the ignorant stick over and over and over again.
Once again, reading this reminds me of that whole debate about playing chess with a pigeon.
Yes.
Playing chess with a pigeon is like arguing with a stupid person. No matter what happens, they're going to knock all over the pieces, shit all over the board, and then walk away looking like they've won.
Claiming victory, yes.
Yeah.
Claiming victory. Okay. I'm going to play the other wrap it up. Okay. That's it for this part of the show. We'll be back live this time, Sunday. Not that it matters, because I'm only going to get the show out on maybe Monday now and in back-to-back. But typically, the second half of the show will drop on Wednesday, first half on Sunday. If you're a patron, which you can be if you'd like, follow the Patreon link or go to patreon.com/overlyradio, and you can become a patron for just $1 a month, and you can get early access to the shows and new whatever I end up doing for our patrons. You know, but I need more patrons to actually put some effort in. So come on down and tell me what you want. In the meantime, hey, let's roll this conversation forward on our website and also on our Facebook, our Twitter, Tumblr, Google Plus, and of course, later on, you'll be able to see the show on YouTube, and of course, you can subscribe to the YouTube and the Twitch channels. wow, this is so hard. I'm still reeling from everything that we went through, so I'm just freewheeling it here. If you've liked what we do, definitely please contribute. But most of all, share the show. Share what we're doing with other people. Share this document with other people. That is of critical national security importance, people. This is national security. You need to do this. Please.
And actually, that's true, because, again, this is the RNC platform.
This is
the Republican hit sheet from here for the next at least 4 years.
This hurts, is what it does. So please, go do that for us and for... Do this for your country. Ask not what you can do for you, what you can do for your country. Anyway, shoot us a note, overlyradiopodcast@gmail.com. Shoot us a text,